So good morning, students. How are you? Myself, Vivek Sawhney, physics teacher. So this time, hopefully, you are all sitting at home, taking precautions due to pandemic disease spread out all over the world, that is coronavirus. You children are the mentors. You can spread the awareness. Might be in surroundings, the people are not educated, but you are enough educated. You are watching the news on the media every day, every hour. So it is seriously a very issue, that is coronavirus. So in India also it is spreading in a very fast, diverse rate. So we need to control it. So children, you better avoid to go out, to go stay outside, to go out for some shopping or something else. Stay at home, stay safe, and spread awareness. Use mask whenever you come for some playing. So better to avoid play this time also. But use precautions, be hygienic. So wash your hand continuously, follow the instructions as given in the media every hour. So it's a need of waking up, need of spreading the awareness of the people. So you are the best mentors to do this. So then hopefully you are sitting at home, sitting idle at home. So it's a quite good option to use your valuable time. So I am here to deliver you the lectures so that you can study at home, you can understand the concepts of your new class. So any doubts, any queries, you can put up on the group or you can call me directly on my number. So today I am going to start with the topic, that is electrostatic, unit 1 of the physics. So in physics, as you know, this is the board class, you need to be very much aware of the syllabi also. So you are very interesting syllabi: electrostatics, current electricity, magnetostatics, and eddy currents concepts, and mutual induction, self-induction concepts, alternating currents, different electronic devices, optics, as well as electronics, and many more units are there which are intentionally requires a special intention from you, from the board point of view as well as the competitive point of view. So we need to prepare hard for the board exams as well as the competitive exams. So I am starting with the very first unit of the class 12, that is electrostatics. So electrostatics, you already know. So in here, electrostatics means electro plus statics. Electro means a study of charges. Static means at rest. So electrostatic is a branch of physics which deals with the study of the charges at rest. So at first we discuss with the basic concept of the what is charge. So you already know the charge, already in lower classes also you have studied, there are two kinds of the charges, that is one is positive, one is negative. So already we can define the electric charge as, it's a fundamental physical quantity due to which electrical and other related effects are produced in the matter. So you know, so if two bodies are charged like positive, if two bodies are being positively charged and they bring closer to each other, then repulsive forces will be seen. The two bodies will start tries to go away from each other. Why? If two oppositely charged will bring together, like one is positive, one is negative, they will start attracting towards each other. So this is the basic concept of the charges. So we can say that one body is positive, one body is negative, or in what conditions we will say body is negative. We simply say that a body has, if there are two bodies, obviously one body if have sufficient number of electrons, say I will say for example, if I say one body A have 10 number of electrons, while body B will have 0 number of electrons at this time, but as soon as they came in contact, the electron will start transferring from body A to body B. So what happens? The number of electrons in the body A will start decreasing, while the number of electrons in the body B start increasing. So one body is losing the electron and one body is gaining the electrons. So we can see that the body which is losing the electron becomes a positively charged body, and while the body which is gaining the electrons is a negatively charged body. So in this way we can say how the body becomes a positive or how the body becomes a negatively charged. So there are basically two types of charges, that is, one is positive, one is negative. So negative means the body is enriched of electrons, the body is gaining the electron continuously, and positively charged means body is continuously losing the electrons. So now we have different charging methods. Simple like this, rub your hands, or simply I said, rub any two bodies, or simply I said, if I rub any scale with my hair, so we see the scale get charged. It is due to rubbing, or we'll use the word rather, it's a charging by friction method. So friction means you need to rub two bodies and the charge from one body goes to the other body. A physical contact is required among the two bodies for the bodies to get a charge by a friction. But one more concept we have, that is charging by induction. That is, if I say one body is charged, suppose it's a positively charged and second body is uncharged, for example. But as soon as they came in contact, it's not required a physical contact on the two bodies. So from some distances, this process can happen. So as soon as this body comes near to this body, opposite charge, if say it is a positively charged, then the nearer face of this body will get a negative charge induced, while the far end of the body will get a positive charge induced. So this is also one of the methods to charge an uncharged body. But this is, it's not mandatory for the two bodies to become in a physical contact. So this concept is, the charging concept is called as charging by induction. And we have basically defined the two methods. One is charging by friction, that is, we need to rub two bodies for the bodies to get charged. A physical contact is required. But in charging by induction, no physical contact is required. Only the charged body needs to come nearer to the uncharged body, and whatever the charge is given on the given body, opposite charge will get induced on the second uncharged body. So this is the way how the body gets charged. So there are two basic charging methods. One is charging by friction and one is charging by induction. Okay guys, okay. So this is a basic concept of charge. And continuing with the charge concept, I will discuss some of the properties of the electric charge. That is, first, we can say that additive nature. The charge is additive in nature. What it does, it implies. It does simply implies that if somebody is non-uniformly charged, means here is say plus 2 times charge, here is minus Q, whatever. So the net charge on the body can be given by simply by addition of two charges. And it will be plus 2Q plus minus Q. Simple, add the two charges, you will get net charge on a given body. So additive means the charges can be added simply following the algebraic expressions. Simply following the mathematical algebra, that you can add the charge, different charges on a given body, and then can give the net charge on a given body. Right? So this is the first property, that is additive nature of a charge. Second is very important, that is called as quantization property, quantized we use the word charge is quantized, what does it mean? If I say there are n number of electrons in on a given charge body, then total charge is given as q equal to plus minus n times e, where n is 1, 2, 3 and so on. So in simple word I would say, what does quantization implies? That the charge on a body is only allowed as an integral multiple of electronic charge. It is not like the continuous values of the charge, it's not like that. So we have to give some integral values like plus 1e, like plus 2e, like plus 3e, so on. So such type of values are allowed for the charge on a given body. It's not like that we say plus 1.5e or plus 2.2e, such type of values are not allowed. So quantized means simply means discrete. We use the word discrete, and that discrete is word given as by n. N is given as 1, 2, 3. Means so there are some discrete values which decides the charge on a given body. So this is a very important concept when you are starting with electrostatics. You should be clear of the basic properties of the charge. So first is additive, that is charges can simply be added. Then second is quantization, that is the charge on a given body is quantized. It exists as a discrete multiple of electronic charge E. And third property I will say as it is a conservation of charge. It means charge is always conserved in a given process. So you already studied the charge conservation or energy conservation, momentum conservation. A number of conservation laws have to be followed for a system to be allowed in the nature. So one important is conservation of charge. If I say a simple reaction, that is uranium, for example, I will take, in order to understand the concept of conservation of charge, I will take simple example of uranium-3892. Suppose it breaks and it separates, say, thorium-234-90 and helium particle, or it also called as alpha particle. So this is a basic reaction of uranium 238-92, 234-90 and 402. If I will say topmost, this is a 238, this is 234, and if I add these two numbers, 234 plus 4, it becomes equal to 238, or 90 plus 2, it becomes equal to 92. This is like mass number or atomic number we are checking out. Similarly, if we check out the charges on this entire right hand side and entire left hand side, it also becomes equivalent. So this is how charge conservation still works in this particular reaction. So overall, there are three basic properties of the charge, that is additive, quantization and conservation. So I hope you are understanding the concepts. So this is the basic concepts of the electric charge. Now a very important concept comes ahead, that is Coulomb's law. Coulomb's law. Simply, what is Coulomb's law? In simple what I will discuss. Suppose you have two bodies A and B, and let they are placed at a distance R from the centers. So Coulomb said the force of attraction or repulsion between the two bodies, that is say F, that is directly proportional to product of two charges on a given body. So F is proportional to Q1, that is charge on the body A, Q2, that is charge on the body B. So F is directly proportional to Q1, Q2. And it also says the force among these two bodies depend inversely to the distance among the two bodies. That is, it is grossly proportional to R square. The more the distance among the bodies, lesser will be the force of attraction or repulsion. Very simple, it is also called as an inverse square law. Simple for this, you can say that I have two magnets. So more closer they are, the more force of attraction or repulsion I can feel. But more far away they are, obviously there is no force of attraction or repulsion among these two bodies. So more, less are, more the force. More the are, less the force. So both are very inverse. We use the word inversely proportional. So this is also called as inverse square law. That is, force between two bodies depends inversely to the square of the distance r. So this is number one equation, this is number two equation. And if I combine these two equations, one and two, I will get F is proportional to Q1, Q2 by R square. So this is a combined form. I am just combining two equations, 1 and 2. So I can write simply F is proportional to Q1, Q2 divided by R square. And if I need to remove this proportionality sign, I just need to put up a constant. Say K, Q1, Q2 by R square. So this becomes a formula calculate the force among the two charges. So F equal to K Q1 Q2 by R square, where K is called as Coulomb's constant. So one constant is defined as per the Coulomb's law. So it is called as K as a Coulomb's constant. So K, so this is in general. So we have in general, that is general expression, that is F equal to K Q1 Q2 by R square. So in, I will summarize again the Coulomb's law, that the force among the two charged bodies placed at some distance apart, say R, that directly proportional to say product of the charges Q1 Q2 and inversely proportional to the square of the distance. And if I combine these two equations 1 and 2, I will get F is directly proportional to Q1, Q2 by R square. Or if I remove this proportionality sign, I will get a constant, say K. So I will have equation F equal to K, Q1, Q2 by R square. This is called as Coulomb's law, which helps to calculate the forces of attraction or repulsion among the two given charged bodies. So this is the final formula for Coulomb's law. Okay, so now I will try to write this Coulomb's law in vector notations, because we know the force is a vector quantity. Vector quantity means these have a numerical value as well as direction. So we need to define the direction of the forces also among this process. So next concept is, I am continuing this concept, I am just writing this Coulomb's law in form of vector notation, right? Suppose I will draw a diagram again. I have say two charges Q1, Q2. Two charges again Q1, Q2, separated by some distance say R. Similar to this diagram, Q1, Q2, separated by some distance say R. Now, already you studied a concept of unit vector in class 11. The unit vector is used to define the directions whose magnitude is 1, but it is usually used to define the direction. So here I am using the concept of the unit vectors. Suppose Q1 to Q2, we have a unit vector of R1 to cap. This is the way to write unit vector. So R1 to cap is a unit vector from 1 to 2. And similar, we can write R21 cap from 2 to 1. This is again unit vector R1 to cap and R21 cap. And then also now the direction of the forces. Okay, so this is like I will write F21. See, so this is for the forces, I will write in a reverse way. That is, what amount of the force exerted by charge 1 on the charge 2. This is the notation to write F21.
So how, what amount of force charge 1 exert on the charge 2? That is written as F21. So you will see, so 1 exerting the force on charge 2, obviously its direction is like this. And one thing to be noted are, 2-1, if I say, this is R21, this is 2-1, so this is the direction of R21, this is the direction of F21. So both are in reverse direction. This is the main thing you have to note. So similarly, if I write F12, what does it mean? F12 means what amount of force second charge exert on charge 1. So this is Q2 exert force on Q1, in direction will be like this. And again, one thing to be noted that R21, R12 and F12, the directions, these are again in reverse directions. So this is the main thing to be understand, how to write the unit vectors, how to write the forces. So always keep in mind, we usually write forces in a reverse way, but unit vector in a direct way, and these are in opposite directions. Right? So this is the way to represent the forces as well as the unit vectors among the two charges. Now, if I use the expression of force F12. So we will use a simple expression, that is KQ1 Q2 by R scale, but using the unit vector concept. So see, I can write KQ1 Q2 by R square. So F12 is in the direction of R21. This arrow is same. So I will write here R21 cap. And similarly, I can write F21 equal to KQ1 Q2 by R square R12 cap. Again, these are in opposite, these are in the same direction, right? And as per the diagram, we are easily able to see that R12 cap is equivalent to minus of R21 cap. These are equal and opposite. So using this expression, we can easily conclude that from 1 and 2, if we use this, we can easily conclude that F12 equivalent to minus of F21. That is, the forces are equal and opposite. The two charges, the forces they are exerting on each other, they are equal and opposite. We can also say that it's somewhat like to Newton's third law of motion. Action and reaction are equal and opposite. On similar ground, we can say that this type of concept also applicable to charges. So the two charges in a system exert forces equal and opposite to each other. So this is a way to write the forces in the vector notations. This is a very important concept, understand clearly, because the next concepts are entirely based on this concept, that is vector notations. Right? So this is the one main result we have drawn, that is F12 is equivalent to minus of F21. Right? Okay. Now we will discuss about the constant K we are using in this force formula, that is K, or I have already called it as Coulomb's constant or a force constant, you can also say. So K is defined as 1 by 4 pi epsilon. K is defined as 1 by 4 pi epsilon, or it is also written as 1 by 4 pi epsilon or epsilon r. So what is epsilon? So epsilon is called as permittivity. Epsilon. It is termed as, named as permittivity. Right? So, and also we can assume it as, if charges are in free space, we can assume it as 1. That is relative permittivity. Actually, what's a permittivity is? It describes the, because now the forces between two charges will depend in what type of medium they are kept. Either they are kept in air or vacuum or some medium, say water, something else. What type of medium we are using for experimenting the process of calculating the forces among two charges. So it depends upon the medium. So conductivity indirectly correlates this concept with the presence of the medium also. Right? So, and this is called as conductivity, right? So K is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. If I take it as epsilon r it as 1, I can simply quote my relation as K equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. And we have a fixed value of epsilon naught given by Coulomb's law, that is 8.854 10 is to power minus 12 Coulomb square per Newton per meter square. This is a fixed value given, defined by the Coulombs. So 8.854 into 10 is to power minus 12 Coulomb square per Newton per meter. And if I use this value here, put the value of pi, solve all the expression, I will get K as 9 into 10 is to power 9. So value of the complete fraction. So K we will simply get 9 into 10 is to power 9. So ultimately this is the value of the K we have calculated. So I can simply say that force is equivalent to K Q1 Q2 by R square, or either you can write it as 1 by 4 by epsilon naught Q1 Q2 by R square, or either you can also define the value of the K, 9 into 10 is to power 9. Okay, so this is a one value we already solved of the force, that is K. Value of the K, this is the complete Coulomb's law, that is F equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon q1 q2 by r square. Okay, so next is, if I define it more, that is epsilon r, we can also define epsilon r, that is relative conductivity, as ratio of the forces, that is F divided by Fm, that is F is a force. If two charges placed in vacuum, the force between two charges placed in vacuum divided by force between two charges placed in some medium. Epsilon r, or either you can also define epsilon r as k equal to epsilon r. It's already the same things, epsilon r and k. So for vacuum, like we say, for vacuum k is 1, for air k is 1, for water the value of k is 80. For dielectric, it is also called as dielectric constant. So it's given as different names, k. For some particular mediums, these are different values. So, also we can say that, suppose for example, to understand this, if I say, let us put up the two charges in the water, then what is the change in the forces? This is my question, short question. Right, so for calculating this, I can simply use, I need to calculate the force in the medium, Fm. So Fm becomes F divided by K. If I say my question is, I have put up the two charges system in a water, then what is the change in the force? So for water, K is 80. So I will just write F by 80. So ultimately, the force in the medium get reduced by 80 times. So this is how you can use a concept of the K if it is given for some particular medium. So it's a concept of the conductivity, or it indirectly correlates the presence of the medium and how the forces between the two charges get affected by the presence of the medium, right? So, okay student, so today we will wind up with this. Go through the lecture again, if you have any doubts, call on my number or put up your queries in the group. So, stay healthy. Thank you.